Can everybody hear me okay? I'm going to try to speak up. I may walk around a little bit too. I get restless and antsy if I stay in one place too long. But first of all, thank Access Sports for inviting me to this talk. And I think it's great. I think it's very timely, particularly what's happening across the country. But what's most visible is what's happening in the NFL. And just this weekend, there were three very high-level, high-profile athletes, two very high-profile athletes who were concussed and are going to be removed from competition. And several of them may miss their next competition. So I think this is really very timely. And they told me to talk for about 15 minutes. And believe it or not, it's so much harder to come up with a talk and talk for 15 minutes than it is to come up with a talk and talk for an hour, particularly on a topic as complicated and broad as sports-related concussion. So when I started putting this talk together, I was thinking, well, maybe I'll talk about some statistics and how many people have injuries and, you know, what sports are most at risk. And I thought about it a little bit, and I decided that the best approach would be to think about when people come into my office, so young athletes and parents, what answers do they want to have? What questions do they want to have answered? So that's where I started with this. And I think just conceptually, concussion is really a difficult thing for people to get a grasp on. Because we understand that there's an injury, but people don't really understand how that injury manifests itself in symptoms, and they don't really understand that if there's an injury there, well, why can't I see it on any tests, on any CAT scans or MRIs if I've injured my brain? So one of the things I thought we'd do is just define what a concussion is. And every few years, there's large consensus meetings of these experts from across the world, actually. Dr. Moser is one of them, participated in that in these conferences. And one of the definitions that they came up with was this. Well, first of all, concussion, I tell my patients, concussion is a form of mild traumatic brain injury. And people will split hairs, and some will say mild traumatic brain injury is different from concussion. Some will say they are exactly equivalent. I tell people, you know, really, this is a type of mild traumatic brain injury. That's what we're dealing with. And that's important for people to understand, because that concept of traumatic brain injury is a little bit easier to understand. So look at this definition. It says, a complex pathophysiologic process affecting the brain induced by traumatic biomechanical forces. All right, perfect. So I'm looking at them, I'm seeing a lot of faces. And when I first looked at this definition, I said, what the heck does this mean? But I started to look at it a little bit more closely, and I actually believe this is a fantastic definition of concussion. Let's kind of go through it step by step, and I'll show you what I mean. All right. So at the top of each slide, I've got the definition and then a couple of words highlighted. So in this one, it's traumatic and forces. So in order for anyone to have a concussion, there needs to be trauma and there needs to be force. And this can come about in a variety of different ways. It can be as simple as there is a blow or trauma that's administered to the head, face, or neck. And those things are really easy to see. You get those high-profile hits in football, those receivers going across the middle, people getting slammed to the ground, you see their heads bouncing off the ground. You know, whatever the case is, those are pretty easy to see sometimes. There's other cases where you can get concussion and there's really no identifiable direct trauma to the head. And where does this come from? Well, force, when there's trauma and force to any part of our body, it's transmitted to the other parts of our body. So you can have trauma that's administered to your trunk, to your shoulders, to your arms. And if it's sufficient enough, it can be then communicated and transmitted up to the head. It can also cause some jarring of the head and neck back and forth. And these are other ways in which people and athletes can develop concussions. All right. So now in this slide, I've highlighted the word brain. And this may seem like I'm oversimplifying it, but this is an important part of the definition. This is a process that affects the brain. So if you pull a muscle, you know that that process affects the muscle. Right? If for anyone who gets sick, if you get an infection in your lungs, you know that that affects breathing. So if you have an injury to your head, it's going to affect the brain and how it works. And how this is most commonly manifested is you have this rapid onset. In most cases, within minutes. There are some times where it can be delayed for some time. And those are the cases that become a little bit more puzzling and are difficult to identify at times. But usually, within minutes, people develop these symptoms of impaired neurologic function. So the brain isn't working as well as it should be before. Now, typically, the symptoms will recover spontaneously over a matter of time. But it's these symptoms and these signs that we really want to be able to identify. So in medicine, we talk about signs and symptoms. So signs are something that I observe or somebody else observes in an athlete or a patient. And symptoms are the things that are experienced by the individual themselves. So when we're talking about this as really as a public health concern, we really need to ensure that everyone involved in athletics knows what the signs of a concussion are so that they can quickly identify an injured athlete and remove them from competition so they can be evaluated. And we want to educate our athletes so that they know what the symptoms are, so that they know what to expect. If they are experiencing any of these symptoms, they can present themselves to their coaches or trainers. But also, just to have an understanding of, in the coming days, what types of things are they going to be feeling? Because a lot of athletes, they don't understand why they're feeling the way that they are. All right. So, signs of concussion. So I'm going to grab my water. Signs of concussion. The biggest one, the one that people look for and the most obvious, is loss of consciousness. But really, in most sports concussions, the vast, vast, vast majority, in greater than 90% of identified sports concussions, there is no loss of consciousness. So that's not, you can't hang your hat on just waiting for someone to lose consciousness to identify them with a concussion. Disturbances in memory. These are a little bit more common, but are certainly not there 100% of the time, and tend to be very short in duration. So usually there's a time just prior to the injury that the athlete won't remember. Most often they won't remember the impact itself. Sometimes they'll remember parts of the play. Sometimes they won't remember the whole play itself. Sometimes they might even stretch to a couple minutes before, but it's rare. Usually it's just a couple of seconds or just the brief moments before impact. And then usually a time after the injury itself. And where they don't really remember. They may say, well, doc, the next thing I remember is I was lying on the ground, or the next thing I remember is I was on the sideline because that play was over. But things aren't really clear. And a lot of athletes really struggle to remember what happened because it's a very uncomfortable feeling to not remember what's happened to you. And I try to tell my patients, I don't want them to rack their brains trying to remember the injury or what happened. Because when you have a force to the brain is not working like it's supposed to be, and it cannot make those memories. So it's not like those memories were there and they can't remember them. Those memories were never made. So there's nothing there to recall. And that's okay. It's not terrible. It's just a normal part of the process. So certainly if anyone appears dazed or stunned, if they're confused about their assignment, if they're forgetting plays, if they're unsure of the game, the score, the opponent. You know, most athletes, they know what's going on in a game. Even kids who aren't really totally engaged and aren't the most competitive ones in the world, they know what's happening. They know who they're playing. They know the score. They know the situation. If they start to lose track of those things, that's definitely a warning sign. If they're moving clumsily, so if they don't appear as coordinated, if their balance is off, these are things that we're going to be looking for. Or if they're answering questions a little bit more slowly, it's just assignment. They're not thinking as quickly and as clearly as they should be. And if there's any changes in their behavior or personality. What about the symptoms? And I should say, I lifted these completely from the University of Pittsburgh. I've got to give credit where credit is due. So symptoms of a concussion. What are our athletes going to be feeling after they've had this injury? Feeling foggy, feeling groggy, feeling sluggish, feeling slowed down. they just feel like they're moving a little bit more slowly. They can't think and process things as quickly as they could before. People describe being in a haze, being in a fog, just not feeling quite sharp. And it's sometimes it's hard to put it into words, but those are the types of ways that people will describe it. Now, change in sleep patterns, so of course we're not going to see that immediately after injury, but any change in sleep patterns, so it could be people sleeping more than usual, it could be people sleeping less than usual, it could be difficulty falling asleep, it could be difficulty staying asleep, it could be feeling tired and taking naps during the middle of the day. Fatigue is a big one, just not having the energy, feeling like they get just wiped out and drained from even the simplest of activities. Very, very common, and we'll talk a little bit more in just a couple minutes about why that may happen. Headache is probably the most common symptom. Nausea, of course, problems with balance or dizziness, changes in vision, double vision or blurry vision. Sensitivity to light or noise, also a very, very, very common symptom. Folks, the sun bothers them, interior lights bother them. Sometimes they feel like they feel better if they're wearing sunglasses or if they're laying down in a dark room. Mood changes, irritability, sometimes depression, low frustration tolerance. They find themselves being snappy, so they're snapping at their parents, at their classmates, at the people around them, and sometimes it gets so bad that it really interferes with their relationships. And so you've got somebody who's at home with mom and dad and or with roommates, and they're not feeling good, and people are trying to help them, but they're irritable and not allowing any help, and now you've got somebody who becomes even a little bit more isolated. Concentration changes and memory problems. So again, this affects the brain. The brain's duties are thinking, memory, concentration. And if the brain's not working, it can't do these tasks. All right, so now the next part of our definition is that this is a pathophysiologic process. So we can break this down a little bit more. You know, patho refers to pathology. Pathology can mean disease, but in this situation, it really just means abnormal. And physiology refers to the normal functioning of the body and of an organism. So pathophysiology, abnormal functioning. So it's a process that leads to abnormal functioning. All right. A little bit oversimplified, but I really like this picture, actually. I think it's perfect. This is a schematic of what a neuron, a brain cell, looks like. Your brain is just made up of billions and billions of these neurons. And each one of these has a function, and it communicates with the nerves around it. And so, couple parts, obviously. So we've got the main body, and then there's this long part that's called the axon, and this is how the nerve cell communicates with other nerve cells, and this foot process here, which will be connected to another body of a cell over here. And there's this flow of information and electrical activity from this part all the way down this and into the next cell line. So when there is an injury to the brain, it's, you know, the brain is made up of these cells, so we're injuring individual cells. And what happens is this kind of outer, you know, black margin around here that covers up the cell and keeps everything inside is called the cell membrane. And when there's a force and trauma transmitted here, the cell membrane gets stretched. And that's really the first key in the first step in the injury when there's a concussion. And this part here, this long part, this axon, we think is a little bit more susceptible to damage and more susceptible to these stretch injuries, but it can happen anywhere along the cell. So we kind of blew this up a little bit. So now we've got, this is the cell body and this is the axon, the foot process would be down here. And this, forget about all this stuff, but these little green things here, these are important. These are the mitochondria and these are the power plants of the cell. These little structures provide energy for the cell to do what it needs to do. To perform all the functions, to transmit that electrical activity in order to work, you know, the cell needs energy, our bodies need energy, and these mitochondria, they supply the energy. All right, bear with me. This is just another magnified view. This is a cell wall. This is outside the cell. This is inside the cell. In order for a nerve cell to work, it's got to have some of these things. These are just charged particles that are outside the cell. In a normal functioning cell, the cell wall just allows a couple of them to come in at a time. Just a trick of it controls the amount and flow of these particles inside the cell. When the nerve, when the cell membrane, this, gets stretched, it loses this regulation. And what happens is, there's like, it opens the floodgates, and all these particles come inside the cell. This is where the injury is in a concussion, and this is what I'm trying to you know, have people understand, that it's not that the cells are broken, it's not that there's a ton of blood, you know, in the cell, it's not that, or, you know, in the brain, it's not that there's all this extra edema and fluid in the brain. It's this, it's a very delicate injury. So what happens is, these come in and they need to be pumped back out, and the cell needs energy to pump these out. The only problem is, when all those particles rush in, they injure the mitochondria, so they injure the power plant. So which happens through this cascade, and this is this process. So the particles come in, it sets off this cascade, injures the power plant, so the cell can't meet its energy requirements. There's not enough energy in the cell to pump those particles back outside the cell where they need to be. So you end up with this energy crisis, is what some people call it. And this is the core of the injury. This is the abnormal function. The cell just doesn't have enough energy. The brain doesn't have enough energy to work normally. If it's severe enough, it can cause cell death. But really, most of the time, this is a reversible process. And we can't see this on CAT scan or MRI, which are the most common imaging modalities that are used. So everybody comes in and they say, you know, but doctor, the CAT scan was normal. Why am I feeling this? And it's because of this. The injury is at this microscopic cellular level, not at this very large force level. So I know it's a little bit difficult conceptually, but I hope I did an okay job. So the next part is that this is complex. This is not a simple process. So usually there's a graded set of symptoms that we talked about, may or may not involve loss of consciousness. And we can anticipate that over a short course of time, in college level athletes, about 7 to 10 days, in high school athletes, maybe a little bit longer, but we'll anticipate a complete resolution of symptoms. But this is complex, it's not simple. Every time you think you've got every concussion figured out, there's gonna be another one that comes off your field or into your room or into your office or into your house that throws a monkey wrench in it. A small percentage of cases may have prolonged symptoms for a variety of reasons that I've got a feeling we may be able to touch on in the question and answer session. So I want to just do a real quick overview, 2 minutes on treatment, because I really wanted to talk about that stuff more. So as far as treatment goes, there's this idea that we do rest, physical and cognitive rest, which is also very difficult to define and difficult for an athlete, especially a young athlete, to do. Kids don't like to rest. People don't like to rest. So it's hard to prescribe. We think that this is good. There's not great evidence for it, but this is a standard of care. And then what we do is we follow the symptoms, and we wait until the symptoms completely resolve. And then patients will come into my office. We'll discuss their symptoms. We'll see how they're feeling. Hopefully they've come back to baseline, and of course there is a physical exam that's done. It's comprehensive, but some of the most important things are balance, coordination, and then oftentimes we do some neurocognitive testing. Some people may be familiar with some of it. Sometimes we'll do paper and pencil testing. Sometimes we'll just ask people some questions. Sometimes we'll do some of this more formal computer-based testing that you guys may have heard of, such as impact testing. Sometimes we'll send them to neuropsychologists for really more intense neuropsychological testing. Once everyone's asymptomatic, they're back to baseline, no symptoms, physical exam is normal, neurocognitive testing is normal, then we don't just say, okay, you're better, good, get out there, playing a game. Then we do this graded return to play. Hopefully most people are familiar with this. I'll just run through it real quick. No activity, this is that rest period. This is the cognitive rest. And by the way, this is usually done under the supervision of athletic trainers who are fantastic. So the next step when somebody is asymptomatic and clear to replay is light aerobic activity. This is like a stationary bike, swimming, really, you know, non-contact, just get the heart rate up. And you're looking at all of these steps for return of symptoms. If any symptoms come back, then you stop the activity, you have them rest for a day, and then you repeat the next day at the next lower level. Right, so, and so after light aerobic activity, the next day, if there's no symptoms, you would move to sport-specific training. And so for hockey, this would be skating. For soccer and football, this would be running. If there's no symptoms, the next day you go to non-contact training. And now we're adding another level into it. So for, say, soccer, it might be running and dribbling a ball or kicking a ball. Football would be running and catching and passing. So you're adding this element of coordination and multiple planes of movement. There's no symptoms there. They feel good under the guidance of the athletic trainer. The next day will be a full contact practice. Whatever's happening in practice, if it's full contact, they're clear to do it. If there's no symptoms, then again, if there's a game the next day, they would be cleared to return to play. There's some cases in some elite athletes where they maybe move forward a little bit faster, but for the most part, for high school and even college athletes, we do believe that this is the right way to gradually return people to play. All right, so just a quick summary. This is a complex pathophysiologic process. It affects the brain. It's induced by traumatic biomechanical force. For the most part, CAT scan and MRI are normal. There's an anticipated set of symptoms, and we expect these to resolve completely with time. Treatment is really rest, and then once they're cleared, a comprehensive evaluation for graded return to play. It's a list of references I'm happy to share with anybody. Thank you to Access Sports, one of my mentors, Dr. Watanabe, my wife Nina, who's there. Be happy to answer any questions, either now or later. Thank you.